Ryan.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, man. How are you?
I am great.
Thanks for coming all the way to Bedford to do this interview.
Yeah, it was quite the trip. My first time actually leaving Canada on an international flight, so that was quite exciting.
Yeah, Daddy told me this yesterday. I was like, what? You've never been on a plane before?
No, I was very excited when you invited me here, so I was like, why not? Sounds like a cool adventure.
I've got so many questions on that. I won't spend too long on it, but the whole airport experience is just a natural experience when you've done it a lot and you've done it as a kid, but that was your first time, I guess, in an airport departure lounge?
Yeah. Going through security wasn't as bad as I had anticipated. Like, I work on a nuclear research site, so I go through security every day. So it's pretty much the same.
Was there any part of it that was like a bit weird? You're like, this is odd.
Just lots of people. It was just interesting watching all the people coming and going because I got there way in advance of when I needed to so that I didn't have to deal with any of the hassle. So I just got to hang out and then just watch people mosey around.
How early were you at the airport?
Like 6 hours. I was crazy early.
Rookie.
But yeah, I didn't want to take the chance. I heard all the horror stories about how Canadian airports right now. So I was just like, just get there early. Don't even worry about
that's,
it.
That's airport rookie. So if I was, what would you do if you were there 6 hours early, Danny?
Drink.
Did you drink?
I had a few drinks. I went, had some food. And I just listened to some podcasts, reviewed my notes.
I think if I got there 6 hours early, I think I'd be less likely to make my flight than if I got there 2 hours early.
Yeah, less likely to be allowed to get on your flight. Danny's a lightweight. First time taking off, what was that like?
That was quite the rush.
It's wild, right?
Oh, yeah.
It's weird because I've done it so many times. I don't think about it to then sit with somebody who's not been on a plane before. It's quite the experience. All right, man. Anyway, listen, thank you so much for coming all the way here. You can't be a Bitcoiner without trying to spend some time understanding energy. It's a topic that comes up a lot for a number of reasons, but primarily because there is a FUD that comes out with regards to energy or the use of energy by Bitcoiners. And sometimes it's misleading and disingenuous, or sometimes it's concerns over the growth in energy. But with that, we've all, well, a lot of us have spent some time trying to understand the energy market, particularly in Texas. A lot of us are aware of some of the projects that happen at ERCOT. But at the same time, I've also had Alex Epstein on my podcast discussing ideas with regards to energy, and if we were to curtail the use of fossil fuels, what the impact on humans would be. But I also had Andrew Desler on the show talking about the issues with climate change and the risks with that. There seems to be a broad set of people with a broad set of opinions, some who don't believe climate change is an issue or that we can mitigate it. But at the same time, with those who do understand there's issues with energy and energy production and climate, the topic that comes up a lot is nuclear. And I don't know enough about it.
Yeah, nuclear is very exciting right now. Well, with when the cost of natural gas and oil is skyrocketing, that renews the attention on the nuclear sector, which in many places hasn't been doing so well over the last few years. Like, that's what triggered me to start talking about this. I was listening to the way that Bitcoiners were talking about nuclear, and they were seeing the perspective in the American nuclear industry where lots of reactors are being shut down and the industry is atrophying, their supply chain isn't as robust as it used to be. But then my perspective in Canada from working at the research facility, I get an inside view of the progress of where we're going with small modular reactors and refurbishing our existing CANDU fleet. And it's very exciting, the potential that's growing throughout this decade to build a very wide range of different types of reactors to be deployed domestically, internationally. Like, Canada is poised to be a world leader in this technology. Like, we have the full supply chain and we could kick ass, really.
Well, good. Oh, wow. Well, I've got a lot of questions. I want to know everything. I want to know how reactors work. I want to know about the risks. Before we get into that, let's do two things. Firstly, can you just explain to everyone where it is you work, what it is specifically that you do, and what it is the company you work for does?
Yeah, I work at Canadian Nuclear Laboratories. That's Canada's premier nuclear research facility. and it supports the entire CANDU fleet, does research on medical isotopes and various other peripheral technologies that can support the nuclear technology, like hydrogen production development and different thermal storage technologies. So there's tons of research going on all those fronts. Specifically what I do, I'm a lab technologist and I operate a lab that supports the CANDU pressure tube safety surveillance program just by analyzing the hydrogen corrosion of the zirconium pressure tubes that are used in the CANDU reactors, because the heavy water corrodes the zirconium over the course of a few decades, and the risk of embrittlement can cause a potential issue that I believe there was an incident that happened back in the 70s in the Pickering reactor where the moderator water leaked into the cooling water. And it wasn't a major incident, but it was easily mitigated. And now that factor is constantly monitored. Like every year, the reactors shut down temporarily, take these samples, send them to our laboratory, and then we tell them how much hydrogen is in the zirconium, and they use those numbers to determine how much longer life the reactor pressure tubes have.
Amazing. How did you end up doing this?
I was just educated as a chemical technologist, and I had been laid off at the time, and I just ended up like getting a job at the nuclear labs. I just applied for a chemical position.
How big is the site? How many people work there?
About 3,000.
And that's not at a reactor, or is there a reactor there?
There is a reactor, but it is shut down. It was retired in 2018. That okay. was the NRU research reactor that was built in, I think, 1947. So there's a few other smaller research reactors on site that are used for various projects, but our future intent is to build one of the demonstration small modular reactors on our site. So to get that ball rolling, we need to demonstrate small modular reactors before they can go into wide commercial deployment.
Right. Okay. I'm gonna keep an eye on that because I want to come back to the small modular reactors. And also, just tell me your Bitcoin sort of story. Well, like, where did this all converge?
Well, I had been aware of Bitcoin since fairly early on. Like, I had watched various documentaries like Zeitgeist, so learning about how money works and fractional reserve banking, and you go down all those rabbit holes. And then some of the content that I was interested in, occasionally Max Keiser would come up when he was evangelizing way in the early days. And then life moved on. I got caught up more with like culture war type of events and like Gamergate and then all the craziness with Trump in America. It was just fascinating times to pay attention to. But then, yeah, I wasn't really paying much attention to Bitcoin. And I think it was just about 4 or 5 years ago, I had a little bit of money that I cashed out of an online poker site. And they had Bitcoin as an option. So I just cashed it out into a wallet and forgot about it. And then when the price ran up last January, I started to take more of an interest when a few hundred dollars was now worth a few thousand dollars.
Oh, yeah.
And yeah, I jumped right back in, and Max was my first touch point. So I went straight into the Orange Pill podcast, like right off the deep end, and then was listening to him talking about guys like Michael Saylor. And then that led me to Breedlove's podcast and Safedean's podcast. And then it was when I had listened to two podcasts in quick succession with Steve Barber and Adam O, where they were talking about what they were doing with the flared gas. And then that developed a really strong interest in me and how the Bitcoin mining relates to energy infrastructure. And then it was in March or so when the price dumped because an eccentric billionaire that we don't need to even name was ranting about Bitcoin's energy use, and then the price dumped. And then she just randomly threw out this idea. I was like, well, we're going to build SMRs. I was like, why don't we mine Bitcoin with SMRs? That sounds like a great idea. And then she just went about what she was doing and thought nothing of it. And then I just stood there. I was like, yeah, that's a really good idea. Someone needs to be promoting that. And then I started looking out in the community and nobody was promoting that. So I started to become the guy that was promoting that. And then I jumped on Twitter by May and started pushing the idea out there and grow my influence and clout in the Bitcoin Twitter space and start poking guys like Foss and Harry Tsurik and just get their interest in the idea. And then it was in July, this North American young generation and nuclear group that I'm a part of, being in the nuclear industry, they proposed a competition called Innovation for Nuclear, which was very coming up with ideas to support nuclear assisting in the UN sustainability development goals. And like nuclear on its own and the small modular reactors have great potential to apply to all the UN sustainability goals. But then applying Bitcoin mining to the SMRs will significantly improve the economics of deploying these reactors, which will in turn make them even better at applying to the UN sustainability goals.
And then you find yourself in Bedford making a podcast.
Yeah. Yeah. The first podcast, I got invited onto the Compass podcast. And then and then we did one with the full team. I think it was Young Professionals in Energy. That's hosted by Mark Hinneman. And then I did one with BTC Sessions and then the Canadian Bitcoiners. And yeah, now I'm here in Bedford with you.
Amazing. Well, this is very cool. I'm really glad you're part of this Bitcoin community now and out here sharing your knowledge. I want to know everything. I want to know, talk to me, how the hell does a nuclear reactor work? How does it make energy? Talk to me through the physics of it all.
It's just a giant boiler. It just takes advantage of the fact that when nuclear fission occurs, heavy molecules like uranium or plutonium break apart and release lots of energy, and that's captured in various mediums. Typically, it's heavy water or light water. Heavy water in the CANDU reactors, light water for most of the other boiled water reactors throughout the world. There's also molten salt is one of the mediums. Gas and graphite are two other options. And it just runs that through a heat exchanger to generate steam. Steam turns a turbine. Turbine generates electricity.
It's very similar to hydropower in that it turns a turbine, right?
Yeah, except you have to generate the steam first. Hydro is more just passive, using the run of the flow of the river.
Right, but how does it actually work? Like, talk to me. So through uranium, how does it get broken apart? Like, how does that work?
When uranium is configured in a specific orientation and then it's bombarded with neutrons, it will reach a criticality. So criticality basically means that it's generating more heat than is being consumed, it's releasing more neutrons than are being consumed. And then those neutrons will split, and I think it's 3 neutrons will be released for each uranium that is broken apart. And then they have, in order to maintain criticality, they need to keep that at 1. So they have moderators and that will absorb 2 out of those 3 neutrons, so that otherwise you could reach supercriticality, and that's bad.
Bad,
because you don't want too much, and then because that's how.
Yeah, I'm like trying to visualize when you're building it.
Because like I'm not a nuclear physicist myself. Like I'm just a chemical technologist, so I've been just going off the deep end, learning as much as I can for myself. But it's when uranium breaks apart, releases neutrons, and then those neutrons scatter and then break apart the next uranium, and then it just keeps cascading through the reactor. So they have to absorb enough neutrons so that that it doesn't go overcritical, but then they have to make sure that they're not absorbing too many neutrons, that it stays at the right criticality level. Because if it goes subcritical, then it'll wind down and it won't be sustain the fission reactions.
Right. Oh, so the criticality is like the reactions to keep going, keep happening.
Yeah, you just want to find that sweet spot.
And what the hell is heavy water?
Heavy water is just, it's water that has the hydrogen is deuterium. Which deuterium is just hydrogen with a neutron on it, because standard hydrogen is just a proton and electron, but deuterium is a proton and a neutron and with still the same electron. And then there's also tritium, which has 2 neutrons, which is even less common occurring naturally, but it does get produced in the process of nuclear fission.
And why does it take so long to build these nuclear reactors?
Because there's a robust regulatory environment that ensures that they are incredibly safe so that there is minimal risk of an accident. But adhering to those regulatory requirements requires a lot of upfront capital and a lot of licensing and environmental assessments. And those processes can take as much as 10 years before a reactor can get greenlit.
Holy shit.
Yeah. But once you get over that hurdle, especially with SMRs that are going to be built in a fleet design, then you can just start pumping them out like mad. Like, you'll have specific geographies that you'll need to do environmental assessments. But once the licensing is done and all the regulatory requirements are overcome, then we just start building them.
Oh, so most of the regulatory requirements are for a specific design of a reactor.
Yeah. So right now in Canada, there's 12 small modular reactor designs being proposed to come to market. And there's probably going to be 5 or 6 that get chosen at various sizes, from 1 megawatt to 300 megawatts, depending on the application, on grid, heavy industry, or off grid.
And is it individual companies pitch the designs, and then companies choose to take those designs and construct from them?
Yeah. Yeah, like we've got G Hitachi's is working with the Darlington site, NuScale is working with the Pickering site, Moltex is working with the Point Lepreau site, we've got Global First Power is working with the CNL site. I believe there's more out there from like Arc Energy, X Energy, Terrestrial, Starcore, Westinghouse. There's various proposals. Yeah, so at the moment there's only 5, maybe 6 that have been deals that have been announced. But there's probably going to be more, because the first initial goal is to get the demonstration reactors built. And then once that's done, we can overcome that chicken and egg regulatory issue and start building them commercially and potentially for export as well.
So the construction regulations, are they Canada specific, or is that to do with, I know there's the like international nuclear, whatever it is. Is it an international set of standards, or is it?
Yeah, the International Atomic Energy, they have international standards, and then Canada has the Canadian Nuclear Safety Committee. That's the CNSC is our domestic regulatory body. And pretty much the goal is to get it as standardized across the world as possible. Like, Russia has their own regulatory bodies. The U.S. has the...
Can we laugh at that?
Yeah, the U.S. has the NRC. Well, Rosatom actually, like, they have lots of customers lined up to get their reactors.
The Russian ones.
Yeah. Yeah. There's countries throughout Africa and in the Middle East and Asia that are interested in nuclear that they don't really care what Russia's up to.
Wow. We could talk about that separately.
Yeah. That gets into complex geopolitical things.
Yeah.
But they are definitely our competitor, because Russia and China are Canada's main competitors in the SMR game for international deployment.
And will the SMR modules, when they're created and they're approved, will that wipe out any need to build these larger reactors? Is that the death of those? Is the desire just to only have SMRs?
Not necessarily. Like, there's potentially room for all the different types. Like, there's still like the UAE's just built a few large reactors. The Hinkley Point C is almost finished in the UK. I think there's the reactors in Georgia that have been taking a while, but they're almost finished.
Taking a while because
like 15 years.
When you say like the small reactors, what is the scale compared to like a normal nuclear reactor?
The term small modular reactor applies to reactors that are less than 300 megawatts. Like, the conventional reactors are in like 600, 700 megawatt units. Right. And they benefit from the economies of scale, so they can have a wider customer base to share the risk of the costs with.
Well, I have no idea what that amount of power, how many people that services. So if you had one of these SMRs, I mean, how many would we need in the UK to serve 70 million people?
Well, it depends, because it would be locally dependent. The difference is you can build one large reactor and then all the transmission infrastructure to get it to the customers, or you can build the SMRs in like hyper local grids.
You have a look at how much grid the UK grid uses? I'd love to. I guess you might have an idea of what the Canada grid uses. Does Canada have a single grid? Because it's quite a...
It's pretty spread out. Yeah. There's lots of, like, as soon as you start getting further north, it gets pretty remote, and there's a lot of off grid. That depends on diesel. That's the goal of the SMR action plan for off-grid, is to get remote communities off of diesel and upgrade them to nuclear with these small modular reactors.
Okay, but I can't imagine the construction of a small modular reactor is going to be cheap. What's like the estimated cost?
The first of a kind reactors are going to be in the orders of like, yeah, several hundreds of millions, a few billion. But the expected cost of once the technology is mature, the cost will be cut in half. Because once the manufacturing facilities are built and all of the supply chains are developed and the expertise is aligned, that will significantly drive the cost down as more reactors are deployed. But yeah, getting it over those initial hurdles is going to be quite costly and require like public-private risk sharing and capital investment. And
so it says Greater London uses just under 40,000 gigawatt hours. So it says it could be supplied by two or so like large nuclear power plants.
Okay, so that'd be like four SMRs.
Depends on the type of SMR. If you're going with a 300 megawatt unit, then yeah. But if you want to apply it to like a small community that only needs 15 to 20 megawatts, you can build either a few of the really small reactors that are going to be in the 10 megawatt range.
Oh, you can build like tiny versions of these.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the plan. Like, cause we're going to have, we want to build some that are in the 1 to 10 megawatt range, in the like 50 to 150 megawatt range, and then like the 200 to 300 megawatt range. So we'll have a wide variety of applications that these reactors can be applied to.
So the smaller ones, 1 to 10 megawatts, what kind of size geography did they need?
Like a track field, hockey arena.
Oh, wow.
Like, yeah, not much.
Okay. And do they know the construction time on something like that?
They're expecting the smaller ones to be in the orders of like 1 to 2 years, and then the larger ones being like the 5 years ballpark.
So it's really important to get through that regulatory process then.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And are there enough people out there who are available to be able to work, to construct these, to work at these? Is that another thing that has to be worked on to train people up?
Yeah. In many jurisdictions, that is the case. That's why it is being so costly to build the Hinkley reactor and the Vogtle reactor in Georgia for the UK and the US markets, because they let their supply chain atrophy by not building or refurbishing any of the reactors for decades. Whereas in Canada, we are actively refurbishing our reactors right now. The Darlington has undergone refurbishment. The Pointe La Proe reactor has undergone refurbishment. Bruce reactor is currently under refurbishment. So this will extend the life of those reactors for at least another four decades.
What's involved in refurbing it? Is it essentially using the site to put in new technology?
Yeah, a lot of the parts in these reactors are interchangeable. They can just be replaced with new parts, and like the pressure tubes just get replaced with fresh zirconium pressure tubes, and they replace the turbines if they need to. Just anything that's starting to show its age just gets replaced. But the core of the reactor pretty much remains unchanged.
And how much time goes into refurbing a reactor as opposed to like building one from scratch?
Each reactor probably takes like 2 to 3 years.
To refurb?
Yeah.
Okay.
And that has the advantage of like sustaining our supply chain and our workforce and making sure that the industry remains robust and doesn't lose our expertise.
So why has there been so much of a slowdown in the development of nuclear reactors and essentially the decommissioning of reactors? We know Germany has been doing it. We know, I think there's one in California, but we have less nuclear power now, right, than we did 2-3 decades ago. Is that correct?
I believe so, but especially in the West. But then countries like the UAE, they went all out. They're building several, I think like 4 or 5 gigawatts worth of nuclear. I think they just fired up the first one, and there's 3 more set to go over the next 3 years. And they're working with the South Korean design.
Right. Can you have a look at how much power the UAE uses? Because I'm wondering if 4 is enough to provide them all the energy they need.
Well, I think these are like 700, 800 megawatt units. And they build them in, like each reactor facility will have like 4 units in one housing facility.
This is from 2013. It says electricity demand in the UAE has reached 105 billion kilowatt hours.
Right. I don't know.
Those numbers just mean nothing to me.
Yeah, they mean nothing.
It's hard to make sense of these numbers unless you're deeply entrenched in energy. they intend to like overbuild their capacity, use it for like desalination operations, water treatment, chemical processes, hydrogen production. There's all kinds of high intense energy applications that nuclear is going to apply to, including Bitcoin mining.
Okay, so sorry. So these sites are used more than just the production of energy.
Because they use the heat too. Like, because you can instead of running the steam through a turbine, you can direct that heat into various chemical processes and use it for that and for various industries that that need high quality steam to run their operations.
What can you give me some examples of that?
Like ammonia production, hydrogen production, just all kinds of synthetic fuels like methanol. There's going to be quite a few. And then it can also be used in like mineral refining processes, just mining in general. They want to use them for the oil sands in Alberta to get them off of natural gas. And that will dramatic, because they can provide both electricity and the steam to the oil sands operations.
Wow. I mean, it's wild how, for so long, there seems to have been this kind of, it's like aversion to nuclear power. Yet there's all this kind of like amazing technology that's been developed to expand its use.
Yeah, there's a very strong and well-funded anti-nuclear activist lobby that has had a lot of momentum for the last few decades. And then they really ram home the Chernobyl and Fukushima as a reminder that nuclear power is bad. But there's been other chemical plant accidents and various incidences that dwarf the amount of devastation caused by the nuclear accidents. Like that explosion that happened in Beirut a few years ago, like that was more devastating than all of the nuclear disasters combined.
Really?
Yeah. Like,
oh, I guess
thousands
so, yeah.
of people died in that.
Did they? Thousands? Can you
at least a few hundred. Like it was right in the middle of a port in a major city.
I remember
and it was just fertilizer that was left unattended for probably at least a few years, decades.
I remember seeing the footage of that. Was wild.
It says at least 218 deaths.
And so we know
7,000 injuries.
Wow. And cost, did it say the cost of the damage?
Property damage, 15 plus billion.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
In a country that cannot afford it. Yeah. That's interesting because I heard recently that only one person died at Fukushima, and that's been contested. And I can't remember the number for Chernobyl, but I've got a feeling it's like 24.
Yeah, it's like a few dozen.
28.
There's only a few dozen that can be directly attributed to radiation.
Actual deaths.
Yeah.
But,
Approximately 30.
It's approximately 30. I wonder if that's people they're talking about people who died.
Immediately.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm wondering how, because there must have been an increase in cancers.
It said in the seconds to months after the disaster. This isn't it.
Yeah.
I think maybe it says 60, but I don't know how they even pull that.
But even that, because if you didn't know, if somebody said to you, Danny, like prior to all this, how many people do you think were killed as a result of Chernobyl? I would have said thousands.
You'd guess at least.
I'd assume thousands got cancers and died.
The way that it gets hyped up, that is what a lot of people believe if they're not properly educated on the topic.
With Chernobyl, what happened? What caused that? I mean, outside of you can place accusations on Soviet Russia and incompetent management and processes, but like, what was the actual cause of the meltdown?
I believe they were doing a test that required them to turn off some of their safety mechanisms. I think they were trying to see what would happen when they would just let the reactor wind down naturally. But from what I understand, that there was a lot of stored energy in the graphite that's used to contain the reactor. And then something happened and then it created a steam explosion. And then it just went, once the steam explosion blew out the reactor core, then that caused wider issues with releasing the radiation from inside of the reactor.
It could have been a lot worse though, right? We know of, is it the three guys who had to swim under, and there was like something to do with under, there was like something was leaking. I seem to remember it from, I don't know if I remember it from reading about it, or it was from the not the documentary. Did you watch the series, the Chernobyl series?
I have not actually watched that one.
Oh, it's incredible. It's brilliant. It's well worth watching. But my understanding of Chernobyl is that it could have been a lot worse.
Yes. Yes.
Whereas Fukushima is Fukushima slightly different. Is that it was more because of its location, with regards to the earthquake.
It's also hard to quantify how the cost of Chernobyl being basically a wasteland ever since.
Well, and the immediate cleanup.
A lot of people actually don't know about Chernobyl is that there was two other reactors on that site that continued operating for another decade.
Really?
Yeah.
I never knew that.
Yeah, they kept them going. And now the area around Chernobyl is quite the robust wildlife preserve that's been doing quite well from what
Three
I understand.
Fish.
That Simpsons did not do a good job of promoting the nuclear industry.
But actually, that's something I was told.
That's what Harry Suddick said.
Yeah, Harry Suddick. Was it Harry? Harry said the Simpsons actually had a real negative, it's been really bad for the nuclear industry.
Well, because it had imagery of Mr. Burns storing barrels of green goop in a neighborhood park and just crap like that. It just throws off people's perspective and they see the green fuel rods. It's it's not like that at all.
So we'll separate Chernobyl and Fukushima. With what happened at Chernobyl, what is the risk of similar kind of meltdowns or its reactors now? I mean, are they so safe that it's almost impossible to happen?
CANDU reactors are the safest design in the world. From what I understand, they have at least three, maybe I think four fail-safes that will result in them, if an incident were to happen, that the reactor would be shut down and they would, they would drop the moderator rods in and that would reduce the criticality of the reaction and slow down the production of neutrons. Or if it was worse, they have a chemical poison that would be dropped into the reactor that would completely cease all reactivity within the reactor. But the difference between those two applications is if you just have to drop the moderator rods, that's an easily recoverable situation. Whereas if you have to completely poison the reactor chemistry, you have a very costly process of recovering from that.
Because
the entire the reactor chemistry needs to be reconfigured from scratch.
Right. So that's a last kind of case scenario.
Yeah. But it's incredibly unlikely for that to even occur. These reactors are built with defense in depth for all their safety measures that the likelihood of them even coming close to that situation is incredibly rare, but it's required to have that backup just in case that incredibly rare event were ever to happen. In Fukushima, they did not expect to get hit by an earthquake and then a tsunami. And then had they had their backup generators at a higher elevation, they would have been able to sustain cooling power to the reactor that would have prevented the reactor from going critical and releasing radiation into the environment.
Yeah, so how does that actually happen? How does radiation get into the environment? What's gone wrong at that point?
Well, it's mostly from the steam explosions, because that just releases a lot of energy, but that steam is in the vicinity of nuclear material, fissile material, so it will carry with it the fissile material and then release that into the atmosphere, stuff like cesium and then tritium in the water.
But if radiation is so dangerous, and it was released into the atmosphere at Fukushima and certainly at Chernobyl, are the risks of radiation overstated?
They are. The radiation, from the reactor accidents, the really dangerous nucleides that come out of an accident are very short-lived, so they're only dangerous for a very short time, a few months to a few years.
I mean, I wouldn't say a few years is a short time.
True. Well, relative to the grand scheme of things.
So why have they stayed out of Chernobyl for so long?
Public perception, just everyone just scared of the situation, because it was very, very hyped up as a scary situation.
And they did to build a massive iron dome to put over it, right?
Yeah, they entombed it in a large, they just dumped concrete in there and just...
Why did they do that?
Just to contain it. Because, concrete has good moderating properties to absorb neutrons, so it really prevents any potential of a criticality accident from reoccurring if there is any radioactive fissile material still present at the site.
So you would say then, therefore, nuclear as a source for energy generation is what, the safest or one of the safest?
Per kilowatt hour generated? Yeah.
So the lobbyists, the people who are against nuclear, what is their, if, you know, try and put yourself in their shoes of their rational arguments. What are their rational arguments against nuclear?
It's expensive. It takes a long time to build. And when there is an accident, it is incredibly sensational.
But expensive is a problem that can be solved through economies of scale.
Yeah.
The length of time to create, I mean, if you want this sort of energy, you've got to start at some point. And again, that will become more efficient over time. So I'm thinking more with regards to their concerns with regards to danger in the environment. So these people who are uneducated?
Some of the older reactor designs, like their concerns were more founded, but as the technology has matured, they haven't really seemed to update to keep up with it. So they still repeat the same talking points that they did in the 80s.
Which it's
dangerous, expensive, it takes forever to build.
But what is the danger in the old reactors?
It's just that they don't have they don't fail into a safe state if something were to go wrong. They require active measures to shut down the reactor if it goes supercritical.
The other thing would be the waste, right?
Yes, waste is the other issue, which it's not a large footprint that the waste takes up because of the huge density of uranium, the energy density. But we do have several proposed ideas of how to manage that waste, one of them being a deep geological repository. I think they've started building one in Finland, and there's proposals for various sites in Canada to build them as well. It's just they're limestone caverns that have the appropriate geography that water does not pass through at a very quick rate. These formations have existed already for tens of thousands of years, and they don't expect any changes in them for another tens of thousands of years. And like I said, like when fuel is pulled out of a reactor and it's irradiated, the primary hazard is in the first few years when there's the more dangerous nucleides present.
So the waste, is this the rods themselves once they've been fully used, or is there a green goo of some kind?
No, it's
God, I wish there was a green goo.
Well, like the most liquid radiological waste is the tritium that comes out of these, but there's potential, like tritium is potentially going to be the fuel for fusion reactors.
Okay, we'll come back to that. Fusion reactors, I'll stick with fission for the moment.
Yeah.
Is there more than one type of waste? There's the rods themselves.
There's the rods themselves that are potentially fissile. They need to be stored in lead casks. When they're pulled out of the reactor, they're kept in large pools that are to keep them cool while the harmful nucleides slowly decay. And then once they reach a certain threshold where they're determined to be safe to handle, they get stored in lead casks.
Not drums.
No.
There are no drums anywhere with nuclear waste. Maybe in Russia.
No, there was a good podcast recently. Dr. Chris Kiefer on the Decoupled podcast, he was talking with Mark Nelson about the deep geological repositories that are being built in Canada.
So where are they currently stored?
Most of them just remain on site because they don't take up much space. So, but the plan is to move them into the repositories once the facilities are built. But then that's another chicken and egg thing. You got to go through all the licensing and regulatory, and there has to be community buy-in from the communities that these things are going to be hosted in, because they're one is being proposed on the Bruce Peninsula near the Bruce Reactor, and another more further out in northern Ontario in Ignace.
I'm going to make Jeremy proud now because they covered this in The Fifth Risk. Have you heard of the book The Fifth Risk?
Nope.
It's a book I read a while back, which I seem to bring up in every show after that point, but they talked about the differences between the US and Russia and how they deal with spent fusion materials. And I think they talked in Russia, they just pour concrete over it. but there's certain regulations, for example, in the US with regards to how it's stored and where it's stored. But they also talked about the amount of, I want to say something like all the nuclear waste in the world that's ever been created would be like smaller than a football field or something.
Yeah, it would be one football field stacked a few telephone, like two telephone poles high.
That's about it. I think that's about what I heard. But if we were to increase the number of reactors, that would go up. So we would need something.
Potentially. But the beauty of some of these new reactors is that some of them will be able to use that reprocessed fuel as their fuel to operate.
Huh. So you can reuse. How can you reuse it?
The conventional reactors only get about 5%, maybe 10% of the available energy out of the uranium in the fuel rods. Huh. Because of their designs. And then if they want to use a process called pyroprocessing, where they dissolve the spent fuel rods into a molten salt and then use an electrolytic process to purify it to just the fissile material that's required for a generating reactor. And then that will be able to get potentially another 70 to 80, maybe even 90% of the energy out of these spent fuel. And then that will reduce them to a lot safer nucleides that aren't as long lived and mostly inert salts that can be stored safely like any other industrial output.
And the water, the heavy water, the tritium, did you call it?
Yeah, well, tritium's like, well, heavy water is proton and a neutron. Tritium is proton, two neutrons.
But the wastewater, does that have to be stored in lead caskets or?
Well, that typically gets stored in drums and then it gets.
There's our drums.
Yes, that'll be stored in drums.
And is it green goo?
No, it's just water.
Fuck's sake.
You wouldn't even know. And it's, and honestly.
They should add green to it.
It's not as harmful as people are led to believe. Like the solution, like if you accidentally consumed tritium, the solution is buy a case of beer and take a leak. It'll just float.
Really?
Yeah. It's well. Is
should we do it?
Not. I don't recommend it. But but in incidents where it has happened, it's just it flows through your body so quickly that you just have to overhydrate yourself and just flush it out
with beer. Beer has never been able to hydrate myself.
Beer, water, just something that's going to make you pee.
Okay. Whiskey.
Yeah.
A fuck ton of whiskey.
Just flush it through your system as quickly as possible.
Okay. So everything you're explaining to me is like, well, this is just a no-brainer. Is there enough uranium in the world? Well, where the hell do we get uranium from?
There's tons of uranium. Like Canada is the second largest uranium exporter in the world. And then there's like Russia has some uranium. There's uranium mines in Kazakhstan. There's uranium mines in... I don't know if Australia's mines are still operating because they're in a weird state with their nuclear industry. They
just elected a Green Party, didn't they?
Yeah, well, they swore
they're not the Greens.
No, but a very green.
Yeah.
They're like, they campaigned on a green issues, didn't they?
Well, the Great Barrier Reef's the big problem there because it's dying. So that's like such a buzzword for anyone in Australia.
Isn't that bleaching from...
Yes.
Is that from sunlight?
Or it's the water getting too hot.
The water's getting too hot.
I don't know.
How are they going to cool down the water?
Well, that's a good question. You can also do things like plant coral that helps it grow back and stuff.
Okay. I did... there was a report that came out recently that was saying that the Great Barrier Reef has made quite a resurgence recently. So it's not
as... Is that true?
It could well be. I mean, they have like processes in place where they can try and rebuild it, but I've been and it's pretty white.
Oh, really? Have you dived in it?
Yeah.
Have you been to the bits that aren't white?
We've been... I don't know. It's huge. And I don't know where's good and where's bad, but...
Was it good where you went?
I mean, the fish were good, but the coral wasn't. It was pretty white.
What is it normally? Just like a plethora of colors?
Yeah. I mean, you don't see all the colors that well through like your human eyes because it doesn't go through the water very well or something. But where I was, it was very white.
Right. And that's a massive issue for Australians.
Well, yeah. I mean, it's a landmark, massive landmark, isn't it?
But it's interesting that you can win an election with that as one of the primary...
Well, things. I mean, I think if you ran on green in the UK or in... the US, you'd also, as in like green policies, you'd also do probably pretty well.
Yeah, I don't know, not as well. Okay, so with regards to the actual industry and the production, how much work is there? Like, how competitive is it between different companies who want to build them, or is there a lot of collaboration?
It's a mixed bag. like historically, like, yeah, nuclear utilities are in competition with each other to get the access to market share. But now it seems that there's a lot more collaboration, mostly surrounding the climate change mitigation, and everyone is on the same team in regards to doing what they can for that.
Not everyone.
No, not everyone. But yeah, we get into arguments, well, with wind and solar people all the time, because they think that we can power the entire world with 100% wind and solar, which I think is insane. But
yeah, I think that's pretty obvious now. Going down that rabbit hole, it's become kind of obvious.
Like as soon as wind and solar start penetrating up 15 to 20% in a grid, it starts to have serious negative cost effects, because they overproduce when you don't need them to, and without massive storage capabilities,
that's where the miners come in, buddy.
Yeah, that is where the miners come in.
So if you were to consider like a kind of a grid, a perfect kind of grid scenario, do you think there's a role for wind and solar, or is there no role?
It's geographically dependent.
Okay.
Like in Northern Canada, building solar panels is pretty much useless. but wind is applicable.
I heard a story when I was in Canada, and I met a guy who works up on the one of the oil places when they go mine the oil. And his job is to go out and do repairs. But he said during the coldest parts of winter, you can't go outside for more than like half an hour because like your eyelids freeze over. Was he just scaring me? Is that true?
Oh no, that's legit. Like as soon as you start getting up in like northern Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, it gets cold at the peak of winter, like minus 50 type of cold.
Holy shit. Have you been there?
No, no. Like where I'm, it peaks, like our coldest will touch minus 40 on some days, but mostly in the mid-20s.
Is Trudeau pro-nuclear? Because he seems to have some quite weird policy ideas.
He's very much leaning more towards the green technologies, like especially the environment minister in Canada. He's more towards the wind, solar, renewable types. He's not a big fan of nuclear. But then the labor minister is a big fan of nuclear because it supports a lot of union jobs and workforce in Canada.
And the general kind of population, the voting public, are they pro-nuclear?
It depends who you ask and where. Is people in Ontario that are familiar with a nuclear grid are very much pro-nuclear, like New Brunswick as well. But then you start going out to like BC and they're not big fans of nuclear. But so it's a mixed bag across the board.
Do you know what percentage of nuclear, of energy is nuclear in Canada? Because Danny got me here, it's like 4.3% of global energy demand. Is provided by nuclear. That I was surprised. That was lower than I expected. Mm. Has it been higher? Has it come down?
Yeah, I'm not sure. In Canada, I think for the entire country, I think it's like 16, 17%. But then like in Ontario specifically, it's like 60%. Like Ontario is pretty much hydro, nuclear, and then a little bit of natural gas. They used to have significant coal, but then that was phased out about a decade ago. And the only way that they were able to do that was the massive nuclear assets that we have in Ontario.
There's actually a bit of a conflict here. It says here on this website that nuclear energy now provides about 10% of the world's electricity.
Okay.
That's from worldnuclear.org.
Worldnuclear.org. Okay. Okay. Talk to me about fusion, because I am sometimes a bit of a nerd and read geeky magazines like Focus or New Scientist. And I was recently reading in New Scientist about fusion reactors, and that like significant progress is starting to be made on these. And then it said, we expect the first reactor to come online in like 2056. I was like, huh, I probably won't even be alive.
Yeah, it's a long timeline to get fusion to a commercially deployable state. Like right now, it's still in just the demonstrating with I forget what the name of that large fusion reactor that they're building, I think in France.
Yes, France, yeah.
Yeah. That they just recently achieved the point of producing more electricity and heat than was used to sustain the reaction.
The scarf's getting in the way of this TV.
Yeah, it's a good scarf, man.
Is this the one?
The International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor. Yeah. Yeah, facility in southern France. This is the one I was reading about. Sometimes I don't like Wikipedia as a source because it gives you too much information.
Yeah.
Can you Can you look it up on like Google News?
Oh, yes. Yeah, the tokamak. That's the type of design that that is.
Tokamak. What does that mean?
That's just the name that they gave it.
Yeah. So how does fusion work? How is that different from fission? Because my understanding is that there's no waste.
Because the process of fission is breaking apart heavy elements like uranium, plutonium, whereas the process of fusion is combining small light elements like hydrogen. And that's the process that it's occurring in the sun. And then it combines them and forms helium. But when that happens, that releases a massive amount of energy.
Have you found anything on this?
Yeah.
Okay. European scientists say they have made a major breakthrough in their quest to develop practical nuclear fusion, the energy process that powers the stars. They should have said the sun. Come on. The UK-based JET Laboratory has smashed its own world record for the amount of energy it can extract by squeezing together two forms of hydrogen. If nuclear fusion can be successfully recreated on Earth, it holds the potential to supply virtually unlimited supplies of low-carbon, low-radiation energy. The experiment produced 59 megajoules of energy over 5 seconds. What's 59 megajoules? Is that like power of light?
That's quite a bit of electricity. Okay. But yeah, only for 5 seconds. So they weren't able to sustain it for very long.
Okay,
but yeah, 11 megawatts, that's...
Oh, right. And this is more than double what was achieved in a similar test back in 1997, 25 years ago. Jeez. It's not a massive energy output, enough to boil about 60 kettles worth of water, but the significance is that it validates design choices that have been made for an even bigger fusion reactor now being constructed in France. The JET experience puts us closer to fusion power, said Dr. Joe Milnes, the head of operations at the reactor lab. We've demonstrated that we can create a mini star. That's fucking cool. We can create a mini star inside of our machine and hold it there for 5 seconds and get performance, which really takes us into a new realm. So this is how it works. Hydrogen atoms are heated, fusion reaction, helium, neutron, and energy released. Neutron energy heats water. It's pretty cool. It seems pretty simple.
Yeah, the biggest obstacle is containment because it's a lot of energy and a lot of heat. So it requires like a magnetic field to contain it in a sustained way because the material requirements to contain that sort of heat are going to require some breakthroughs in order to make this feasible.
It creates like a plasma, right?
Yeah.
The fourth state.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's cool though.
It's very cool. And it's going to be cool when it's done, but that's still many, many decades away.
Let's bring it now back to Bitcoin. Like, what is the connection for you in this? Why does this make it interesting for you?
Well, because nuclear reactors are optimal economics when they can run at full capacity, at their maximum capacity factor. And when they aren't, when they don't have the demand to justify that, the economics don't really justify building nuclear reactors. Like if you're running it at half capacity, the economics just don't make sense.
Because of the operational costs.
Yeah, well, like it's mostly the initial capital expenditure, right, and the cost of capital. That is the biggest economic issue with reactors.
Once it's built, what are your input costs? I guess staff, running.
Just operations and maintenance and fuel.
Is fuel expensive? Is the uranium expensive?
Relative to the cost of the reactor, not really.
So the majority of the cost is the upfront cost.
Oh, absolutely.
Whereas I would guess something like natural gas and coal, you actually have a much higher potential cost is the cost of the actual material.
Yeah, especially when they're highly variable markets.
Yeah. And so the price of energy from nuclear is a lot more stable.
Yes.
So is the option here with mining is that it makes the capital outlay, it's going to offset the capital outlay.
Yeah, it'll offset a lot of the economic liabilities that reactors are subject to. Like when they're over-generating, either they just curtail it and earn nothing for it, or they pay other jurisdictions to take that electricity away. So if they were to plug in Bitcoin miners to capture that, they could turn like a liability into a revenue stream. It's like right now in a regulated grid like Ontario, the reactors are paid, they get, I think, 8.7 cents per kilowatt hour, regardless of what the market cost of electricity is and the demand is. So when they have to curtail or sell at negative prices, they that ends up getting put on the taxpayer because it's government subsidized.
It was interesting what you were saying about New York last night.
Yeah, because one of the reasons that New York was able to get away with shutting down Indian Point is because they buy lots of electricity from Ontario and Quebec.
Really?
Yeah. Well, Quebec, a few decades ago, they overbuilt the crap out of their hydroelectric infrastructure, and that's part of the economic profiles that they sell that to some of the northeastern states, Maine, New Hampshire.
Huh, I didn't know about that at all. And New York's really weird with some of their policy decisions. They seem to be anti-everything.
Yeah, it's interesting because every jurisdiction has different political and social issues that they are concerned with. So it depends on your political leaning, really.
So my one concern with Bitcoin miners supporting energy grids is that there's a limitation to how many different nuclear plants and grids that Bitcoin mining can support, because we can't have infinite Bitcoin mining. So the more people that do it, the more competitive it becomes, and the less money or Bitcoin they will generate from those operations.
But that's the game theory, though. If an industry like nuclear were to go deep into Bitcoin mining, that would make the Bitcoin mining network even more robust.
But that's saying security leads price.
Well, potentially. But it's just, as more people have confidence in the reliability of the Bitcoin network, then price potentially goes up as demand goes up. And seeing more legitimate industries taking it seriously will give that sort of confidence that will drive demand potentially.
Hmm.
Like a lot of it is just kind of playing into the game theory ideas. It's going to be hyper competitive, but then that will drive more adoption on both fronts, on mining and just Bitcoin in general.
And is the nuclear community that you're part of, how aware are they of Bitcoin mining? Is it a growing topic?
The people that I talk to, they have no idea until I bring it up to them.
What are they like? What the fuck are you on about, you crazy man?
Pretty much, yeah. I brought up Bitcoin mining to the CEO of my company, and he was like, "What? Like, you mine Bitcoin with shovels? Like typical mining?" I was just like, "No, no."
Dude.
So there was a bit of explaining to lead him down that path.
This is my show with Adam Wright about when they were going to be mining from the methane that's extracted from refuse sites, like the dumps.
Yeah, like that's awesome.
Did you hear what he said about the guy who said, so he was talking about putting Bitcoin miners there, and he said, how do you know there's Bitcoin in these dumps? So is there a bite from your boss?
They've got somewhat of an interest. Like when you tell them that you can set a floor on the cost of energy, they definitely perk up and they're like, well, how does this work?
Huh,
what do we have to do with that?
Tell me more about this.
Yeah,
I want to go to a nuclear site.
You're just plugging in computers and consuming excess electricity, and it's a completely independent market from your local grid that you can sell electricity to.
And it spits out magic internet money.
Yeah, it's money printer.
Huh. Bitcoin printer. So what else is coming in this kind of like area? Because it all sounds really exciting, but then I feel like we're going to be waiting 10, 20 years to actually see anything.
Well, potentially the Bitcoin mining can be plugged into the existing nuclear fleet as it is and shore up the economics right now, because a lot of the reactors that are being shut down are because they're not economically competitive on a grid that has a large share of wind and solar, because they tend to operate at a low capacity factor when there are other intermittent sources providing electricity to these grids.
That's quite interesting, because we need wind and solar and nuclear to all sort of coexist.
Yeah, but you need something flexible that can manage that surplus. That's where I think the Bitcoin mining can come in. Like there's all kinds of other, like the chemical operations that I described earlier, like hydrogen production, desalination, like those I see as more like a secondary tech industries to come in after Bitcoin mining. Like think of it like Brandon Quittam's the pioneer species idea. Like the Bitcoin comes in as the pioneer, seeds the energy resource, and then as more sophisticated energy buyers come into that market, they will push out the Bitcoin miners, and then they'll to be redeployed elsewhere to other projects.
The desalination is interesting because my understanding of desalination is it's just so expensive.
Because it takes a buttload of energy.
Right.
But if you've got nuclear reactors that produce both electricity and heat, they are the optimal technology to ramp up desalination technology.
Talk to me about the economics and financing of this. Like, how does it all work? Is that the biggest roadblock?
Pretty much, because the cost of capital is incredibly expensive when you have like 90% of your operating, your cost of building these things comes before they're even built.
Right. How are they currently financed?
Public-private partnerships between governments and whatever private industry is interested in the technology.
I know that was a big issue with Hinkley. Danny, can you look at how Hinkley was funded?
Yeah.
So I know that was a massive issue with that.
Yeah, like half of the cost of capital on Hinkley, from what I understand, is just the interest on the initial investment.
Crap.
Yeah. So if we can have some way to drive down the timeline on the return on investment, that will significantly improve the capital requirements for these reactors, because they won't, you'll recover that capital a lot faster. So you'll be paying interest for less duration.
Is that what Bitcoin does?
That is what I'm hoping that Bitcoin, how Bitcoin fits into this.
It says here that building Britain's first nuclear reactor since 1995 will cost twice as much as the 2012 Olympics.
What? How much?
20.3 billion at present.
Oh, I kind of think I'd rather have a couple of more Olympics.
Well, a lot of that comes down to the workforce was not maintained over the last few decades. So it's right. Got to be, all of that's got to be completely reinvigorated from scratch. You got to rebuild your supply chains. You have to get the technology rolling again. Whereas in Canada, where we have all the refurbishment plans, that's how we've sustained our workforce and supply chains.
Here we go. To pay for it, the British government has entered into a complex financial agreement with Electricité de France, EDF, the energy giant that is 83% owned by the French government, and China General Nuclear Power Group, a state-run Chinese energy company. Under this contract, British electricity consumers will pay billions over a 35-year period, according to Gerard. We cannot be for sure that in 2060 or 2065, British pensioners who currently school will not still be paying for the advancement of the nuclear industry in France. I mean, it just sounds...
this is through The Guardian too, who are probably anti-nuclear.
Yeah, that's a fair point. We also have... an ability in the UK to make everything significantly more expensive than it should be, and the final product is usually shitter. I don't know why we're so good at it, but we spend so much on our trains, and our trains are shit. it must be our way, Danny.
Yeah. Ryan, you wanted to talk through this, I think, before the show.
Well, yeah, that's just the general plan for the SMR action plan, what the intention is and where they want to apply the small modular reactors to, just for heavy industry, oil sands, remote communities, replacing coal plants. And so like there's a lot of potential for a lot of revenue in these. But my take is that if we include Bitcoin mining on this, we can improve these timelines. We can replace a lot more diesel generators, because the North is plagued with costly energy, like in some places where they have to fly in diesel, like they have like as much as like 90 cents kilowatt hour for their electricity, which is insane. And a lot of that gets subsidized. So then those subsidies that could be going to other community development projects are just going to this black hole of just making sure that they have energy that they can afford.
Yeah. So Danny's just brought up a slide. What's the slide called, Danny?
Where is this actually from, Ryan?
This is from the Economics and Finance Working Group on the SMR roadmap. So I highly recommend anybody that's interested in this stuff to read the SMR roadmap. It's a good 80 pages for each of the documents, but it's well worth getting a good lay of the land as to what's going on, the different community engagement that's going on. Because like a lot throughout Northern Canada, there has to be very strong engagement with the indigenous communities, because they're going to be the ones that are going to benefit from these. But we need to make sure that they are content with the way that we're going about it, which requires significant communication and reciprocal benefits.
Yeah, so this is the macroeconomic, what did it say, action plan, Danny, or benefits, and there's a domestic market. So SMRs meet a fraction of the potential... SMRs meeting a fraction of the potential can provide significant economic benefits for Canada, including up to 6,000 direct and indirect jobs per year between 2030 and 2040, and up to 10 billion in direct impacts and 9 billion in annual indirect impacts over the same time frame. These are conservative estimates and do not take into account potential future use of SMRs, such as powering greenhouses, desalination, and hydrogen production, all of which could increase the overall economic potential. So is there a lot of work that has to go into lobby to actually have this happen?
Yeah. Right now, they're trying to update all the regulatory requirements to reflect the new SMRs because they are a lot safer and they're going to be smaller. So it's going to require different regulations than the old reactors. But we have the chicken and egg problem of we have to demonstrate these things and prove what they're claiming before we can really establish that regulatory framework.
You need a prototype.
Yes. So that's where we're building at the various existing licensed nuclear facilities in Canada. So at Canadian Nuclear Labs, at Darlington, Pickering, Bruce, Pointe La Pro, and potentially a few other sites may be chosen for demonstration reactors. My hope is that when they do build these demonstration reactors, they want to develop what's called the Cedar Park, the Clean Energy Demonstration, Innovation, and Research Facilities, where they're going to bring in peripheral technologies that will benefit from nuclear. So like all the ones that were just listed there, like hydrogen, desalination, greenhouses. And my goal is to have Bitcoin mining included in that as well to show off the economic benefits of having a price floor on your electricity.
It's pretty rad.
That's my hope. Because my hope is that by including Bitcoin mining, we can deploy these reactors bigger and more and come up with a lot more deployment scenarios where that would not have made sense otherwise, because you don't potentially have the customers that you need to sell that electricity to right away. But if you have the Bitcoin miners, you have them available the moment that a reactor begins generating electricity. And then over time, you develop the transmission infrastructure to get wherever you need it to go, or you build the remote mine that's going to be built on that site. And then you can either redeploy the Bitcoin miners, or you can set them up in such a way that they can scale up and down with the day-to-day variability of the local demands. It's a pretty big idea with all kinds of crazy game theory to it, because it's just we need to get the right people to pay attention to this technology. And then once they start building it, and then it becomes hyper competitive, and I'm hoping as Bitcoin miners and ASICs become more commoditized, as we're starting to see that there's less and less efficiency gains for each successive generation of ASIC, that it'll standardize throughout the industry, and it'll be easier for these industries like nuclear to adapt it into their strategies as well.
Well, I find the whole thing fascinating. If people want to read more about this or speak to you, and how do they do that?
Well, on Twitter, I go by Nuclear Bitcoiner. And then,
another name.
Yeah. The SMR roadmap is a good place to learn about what we're doing in Canada. And then there's a bunch of, if you want to go into some nuclear podcasts, there's the Decoupled podcast. There's Titans of Nuclear. Titans of Nuclear. Yeah.
That sounds like my nuclear podcast.
Yeah, that's Brent Kugelmass. And then there's another one. Forgetting.
We'll find it.
Yeah.
I'm
slipping on the name of it.
Well, listen, I'm really grateful that you came in, that you've been educating us on this. I find the subject fascinating. I want to learn more. I find fusion super fascinating. It's just a shame it'll probably happen before I get to see it.
Yeah. And Bitcoin mining is going to supercharge the whole thing. At least my hope.
Badass. All right, man. Well, listen, appreciate you coming in. Thank you for doing this.
And thanks for having me.
Safe journey home.
Yeah, more adventures. Yeah, and with this Negan thing, I'm going to be off to Japan in November to speak at an international nuclear conference. And then I was also accepted to do the same at the Adopting Bitcoin conference in El Salvador a few weeks before that. So yeah, I went from just a guy that just hung out in a lab listening to podcasts, and now I'm jet-setting all around the world evangelizing about mining Bitcoin with nuclear power.
International nuclear playboy. I love it, man. You keep going, keep flying, keep tripping. You got to get up to your age in countries, by the way. Somebody told me that once. You should visit as many countries as your age, because you're always going to new ones. And then you got to stay ahead.
Well, we'll see.
We'll keep traveling, buddy. And stay in touch, and good luck with this.
Thanks.